Batemans Bay, New South Wales, Australia. Today, we're heading to Canberra, where a guest is going to talk about the symbolism and so forth in Canberra, a real heart in Australia for occult symbolism. So, before we go, I need to get this sorted out. Yeah, a little nail in the tire. Okay, folks, we're in Canberra and we have the plan of new Parliament House here, or Parliament House, and that's down here between the trees before us. And right now we're going to meet James Macaron, and he's going to basically talk to us about occultism. Thank you, James.
Thank you. I spent 10 years working for the Australian government in various capacities, a very high paying job. I had this kind of splinter in my mind about various aspects of the esoteric plan of Canberra that I was surrounded by. And the more I was in that environment, the more I learnt about it and the more I didn't want to be there. And so I started to write about this material, and I decided that it was, for my personal journey through life, it was more beneficial to actually walk away from that money and to spend time outlining what I've learned about this place and the deeper pictures, because I realized that a lot of the information that I had figured out was actually not even out there at all. And so I've got a lot, I feel like I have a lot to contribute to this area. And so for the last 4 years I've been writing a book. I've got 3,000 pages, over a million words done. A lot of that's just research that's put in there that needs to be condensed down, but spending a tremendous amount of time and effort and energy into getting this material out for people to, you know, just take in on and figure out for themselves what they want to believe in. Griffin, when he designed this city, his idea was to, Griffin was fascinated by the atmosphere that's created by a city. And you can see the great plan out here is, Griffin called this the amphitheatre, and you can see Mount Ainslie in the background and the Anzac Parade coming down and all this focus coming up here onto Capitol Hill, where you've got this grand Parliament House and with a lake in the background. And so when Griffin was designing his city with his team of architects, one of them is quoted as saying that Canberra was a mythical city that could never take on form and substance. Griffin believed that there was a mystical element to the atmosphere that's created by grand amphitheatres, and so this is the central tenet of his plan. And so when he's talking about it can never take on form and substance, to me that it implies something intangible or maybe etheric or astral about his plan. So looking at the plan, you can see it's designed as an amphitheatre, and essentially it's a giant ritual space. And what ritual spaces serve to do is to drive this kind of stirring up of energetic forces, like Griffin's talking about the lacking form or substance. So we're talking about etheric forces and using nature to amplify the power of this energy that they're trying to harness. So, I mean, Griffin was, his interest was in transcendentalism, which is how humanity communes with God, or an aspect of God, through what's present in all of nature. He believed that, you know, there was a force or spirit present in all things, and so his design of the city was to try and amplify the energy of nature and kind of amplify it into specific places. So we talk about, we see this amphitheater, all the energy is directed towards New Parliament House. All right, we're standing here on the lawns of New Parliament House. We're next to this great granite wall, which is part of the two kind of curved boomerangs that make up probably the biggest architectural feature of the Parliament House here. These curved walls, they're built out of red granite. And so we're going to talk a little bit today about red granite, or granite and limestone, and how that relates to some of the great ancient sites around the world. So Canberra's built on hundreds of miles of limestone plains, and when the city was first established, it was actually called It was referred to by the limestone plains before the city actually became Canberra. Limestone is basically quartz. It's crystal in a lot of ways. Quartz crystal is a superconductor, and crystals can be used to direct and amplify energy. So Canberra is built on top of all this limestone, and then on top of this limestone we've got New Parliament House that's built primarily out of granite. And also surrounding the limestone plains here in Canberra are mountains that are all built of a raw granite rock. So we've got this huge amphitheatre of Canberra that's surrounded by granite with built on top of limestone, and the same features of that are represented here in Parliament House. We'll take a step back from Canberra at the moment and we'll look at the actual Great Pyramid in Egypt. The entire pyramid is actually built out of limestone, and the King's Chamber is a granite complex surrounded by limestone walls. The King's Chamber is the only granite in the entire pyramid. And just like the Parliament House here, they use red granite. The reason they use red granite is red granite contains more quartz crystal than any type of granite. We know that crystal is a superconductor, and so we've got granite here that's a superconductor that's built on top of Canberra's built on top of limestone that's also a superconductor. So we've got this entire ritual space that they've designed here to amplify energy. This and Griffin talks about how the energy of the atmosphere of a city utilizes the natural landscape to amplify this, and we've got all this energy here that's been directed to the center here in Parliament House. These granite slabs here on Parliament House, there's 25,000 of them. If our place end to end, they'll stretch for 46 kilometers. The floors of Parliament House are constructed out of marble, which is polished limestone. So Parliament House is entirely granite or limestone in its makeup. So here's a quote I found about how granite relates to energy with the Great Pyramid. The granite complex inside the Great Pyramid, therefore, is poised ready to convert vibrations from the earth into electricity. What is lacking is a sufficient amount of energy to drive the beams and activate the piezoelectric properties within. The ancients, though, had anticipated the need for more energy than what would be collected only within the King's Chamber. They had determined that they needed to tap into the vibrations of the earth over a larger area inside the pyramid and deliver that energy to the power center, the King's Chamber, thereby substantially increasing the amplitude of the oscillations of the granite.
Yerevan, Armenia. Yerevan, reportedly one of the world's oldest continuously inhabited cities. Notice the beam within the artwork from the Armenian post office, whilst the beam is not in the actual war memorial. The same would apply in Canberra via the ABC Broadcasting Network with the artwork for their program Capitol Hill. You're looking at the National Servicemen's Memorial at the Australian War Memorial in Canberra. I noticed within this fountain that the black part would represent earth, I suspect. I compare this with a certain deck of tarot cards. The circle part would represent air, the triangle would represent fire, and the water represents water. Also, if you look down on it, you will see the eye. You also have the four paths coming into the center. So you have a stack of elements. You can see this within Elements Fitness, also within their logo. They are also in Canberra. But now, with the National Servicemen's Memorial in mind, and I would suggest that this is a key to trying to visualize what's happening at the center of Parliament House, let's now go to the center of Parliament House.
We're here in the center of Parliament House in Canberra right now, right in the center of Parliament House.
So what we can see here at the dead center of Parliament House is this black granite stone. This is the central feature. It's all the energy is being imparted down from above. We've got the central pillar here, the flagpole, and the energy is coming down here. So we've got black granite with water coming out of the central aspect of it, and water is a superconductor, and so it's amplifying the energy that's being directed down here on this black granite stone. The black granite altar stone is used heavily in Masonic design. It's replicated in the Masonic Supreme Council 33 degree temple in Washington DC, and we see it here in the center of a room. So this is our altar, and it's also acting as the superconductor pillar of light here. So if we think of Canberra as an entire ritual space, all this energy is being imparted into this one location. And so we've got this big building here that's built out of granite, and we've got these polished limestone here, and you can see how it's all been funneled and centered here into this central area. See how it's all kind of, see how the lines of the stone are all directed into the central part here. So you've got Parliament House, it's got those red granite boomerang central slabs all built on top of this limestone area here in the limestone plains in Canberra. And so what does this all mean? And so that quote we talked about with the Great Pyramid, how it taps into the natural vibrations of the earth to deliver that energy into this power center. And so it increases the amplitude of the oscillations of the granite. So this all holds energy. And so it's acting to anchor this energy permanently into this spot. And the central pillar in a magic ritual is to anchor this energy into that location to then act as an interdimensional portal, or to allow us to connect to other interdimensional entities. So if we take that concept of a magic circle and a magic ritual and we amplify that to an entire city plan, then this is the central pillar of the magic ritual edifice that's being built here. So, you know, I can speculate in some of my research that this whole city ritual space here is designed to act as a permanent, maybe interdimensional gateway to allow entities to impart their energy onto this area, or to feed off the energy that's here, and simply to affect the consciousness of individuals around this area as well. And we can see around here, all this granite is surrounded by all this red cedar, and red cedar was used to furnish Solomon's temple. Okay, so I wanted to talk about some of the quotes from Guy Freeland's book where he talks about Parliament House. So I'm just going to read a quote here that he talks about this black granite slab. Water flows across the surface of a granite slab, enhancing both its reflective and symbolic qualities. The play of the elements meet again here. Light streams through the airy atrium, striking stone and water. In traditional geometrical symbolism, the square and the cube signify the earth, while the circle and the sphere signify heaven. So here, the square slab of granite represents the land beneath the overarching firmament. Both the flag mask, fixing the axis mundi at this precise point, and the sky are reflected by the surface beneath, thus united heaven and earth. So this is symbolically talking about that connection here between our physical realm here and potentially some interdimensional kind of heavens. And when we talk about the concept of energy flowing through rocks like granite, what we're really talking about is energy, so how stone is light. And this is representative in what Guy Freeland quotes in his book as well about some of the tapestries here in Parliament House. There's one tapestry, it's known as The Light on the Hill, from Prime Minister Ben Chifley's Light on the Hill address, in which he said, "We have a great objective, the light on the hill, which we aim to reach by working for the betterment of mankind." Guy Freeland then goes on to say, "This symbol of light, so strong in Parliament House, is undoubtedly to be carried into the chambers themselves. The increasing lightness of colour was one ascends towards the central skylights, surely telling the members that while they must keep their feet on the land, they should also strive towards that light on the hill." The light on the hill they're talking about, I think, is that interdimensional energy that's being anchored into this spot through this, you know, enormous ritual edifice that they've built here in Canberra. The other feature of it is here in Parliament House is it's heavily furnished with red cedar. And red cedar is the most aromatic form of cedar, and it was used in Solomon's temple. And ancient texts talk about red cedar. The aromas of red cedar are used to allow interdimensional forces to manifest into a ritual space. So the aromas stir up something like the elemental forces that allow for the interdimensional entities to come into that space. So we see here in Parliament House that red cedar features heavily, just like it did in Solomon's Temple. And we'll see across Canberra as we go and look around today how cedar trees and also two other trees, the cypress and the oak, feature heavily in many forms of ancient ritual. And they're here in Canberra as well, featured heavily around Parliament area and the whole ritual space.
On the subject of aroma and incense, hear I, half a sheep, with permission, fiddle and film, an item that has soot in the centre of it, so something would be burnt, probably incense, as a mason suggested at the Sydney Masonic Centre. I also showed this footage to another mason who is high up. He suggested the holes, there are 11 of them, somehow refer to time. Anyway, just showing you what I regard as a ritual item. This item was one of three. There were also three pedestals nearby.
And no, this item is not a giant tea leaf strainer.
All right, so we're here in the mysterious Collins Park. If we look on the map, we're down here, as you can see. And so this is kind of a teardrop shape in Canberra's geometry. It's kind of always perplexed me a little bit into about what it means. So we're here in the park now, and we're looking around. And you can see around us, we've got all these cedar trees. So this park was planted with trees in the 1920s. It features Himalayan cedar and also Atlas cedar, which is a subspecies of the Lebanon cedar. If we look in some of the history about cedar trees, to many ancient people, the cedar was a tree that was considered alive and linked with the gods. The cedar trees were believed to possess a soul and a power, just like humans and animals, and they were seen as growing through a hole in the sky. So the cedar was thought to be the axis of the world and the pathway into the upper worlds of the higher dimensions. And sometimes it was referenced as like the world tree. And in ancient Sumeria, the cedar tree was revered there as and related to their chief god. And the Bible has numerous references to cedar. And as we talked about in Parliament House, cedar was used in Solomon's temple. It's used as an aroma to entice the spirits to the places. So if we're looking at Canberra as a ritual space, this park here with all its cedar, I guess, is symbolizing a connection to the gods as well. So the cedar trees are lined throughout Canberra in many places. So this is the biggest, well, one of the biggest forests of them. There's another at the Canberra Arboretum as well. And I found it interesting that in 2012, the Australian government did a symbolic tree planting of a Lebanese cedar in the grounds of Parliament House. And also the Lebanese president in 2012 had the first visit to Australia by a president of Lebanon, and he planted a cedar of Lebanon in the National Arboretum as well. And the cedar was a sacred tree for the Druids, and the Druids, we know, perform their magic rituals in groves of trees. Okay, we're standing here next to the R.G. Casey building, which is the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. So around standing here, and we've got this green boulevard here that's leading right up to New Parliament House. So if we look ahead here, we can see the mast of New Parliament House, and along the left and right of this boulevard here, we've got these cypress trees. And if we look down here, we can see this whole avenue is lined with them. So I wanted to point out there's a number of locations around Canberra that have these clusters of cypress trees. It's very common around Canberra, and it was for a long period of time I was kind of curious why these trees were here. So let's kind of see what the cypress tree is involved with. The Greeks dedicated the cypress tree to their deities. The ancient Greeks and Romans believed the cypress tree was the first tree the dead would see when they arrived to the underworld. The tree was associated with death. It was a symbol of eternal death, and once the cypress tree was cut, it would never grow again. And typically cypresses are planted in cemeteries. Apollo, in Greek lore, proclaimed that the cypress should preside at every funeral rite. The tree symbolizes sacrifice to the gods of the underworlds. It also represents knowledge of immortal life with God in heaven. I noticed in some of like Eliphas Levi's magic rituals, he used cypress to consecrate the sword that he used in magic ritual. So yeah, it's interesting that Canberra uses these cypress trees in a lot of strategic locations as well. Okay, we're here on King's Avenue, right here standing next to York Park, which is an oak plantation right here. And along King's Avenue, the boulevard here, and looking up to Parliament House, you can see these trees all up and down this avenue. These are all cypress trees. So lining this big boulevard, which is one of the main triangle ley lines here that make up the Parliament Triangle in Canberra. What we've been talking about with the energy of the trees. So we've got cypresses along here, and then we've got this big oak plantation. So we'll walk over there now. Okay, we're standing here in York Park, which is right next to New Parliament House. And we've got this oak plantation. So this is one of two oak plantations in Canberra. The other one is right out near the Arboretum. It was part of Griffin's original plan for Canberra. And I'm pretty sure York Park was probably part of that as well. So the oak trees are, they're trees that are high in starch content, which makes them extremely good conductors of energy. So the oak tree is the most revered tree in many ancient cultures. It was the most revered tree by the ancient druids. It was their holy tree and the king of all trees. In terms of magic lore, the bark of the oak can be dried and powdered, and it's used to unite a person with gods, and it's used in ritual for that purpose. The oak tree is also, it's used in the seat of a chair of St. Peter in the Vatican, and
it's used in the chair here in Old Parliament House.
Yeah, and so I just find it interesting that, like, it's when we're talking about magic ritual edifices, we know that the druids performed their magic rituals in groves of oak trees, and they believed, and the oak trees are the trees that are most commonly struck by lightning just because of their superconductivity. So when we're talking about this whole concept of creating ritual edifices, it doesn't surprise me that they've lined Canberra, like we just saw that road, King's Avenue, lined with trees of cypress, and here we've got oak plantations, and the woods are used in temples and ritual places to impart that additional kind of boost of energy. So here we are in oak plantation in Canberra, and I feel it's just contributing another aspect to this plan to build up that energy that is then kind of directed into that central spot up there in Parliament House.
Hyatt Hotel Canberra, suspected triple tower. Hyatt Hotel Perth, notice the orbs and more. Hyatt Hotel Melbourne, eagles on pillars, same artist, owl on pillar, Belconnen, Canberra.
Okay, we're standing here on Commonwealth Avenue, just outside the Hyatt Hotel. And you can see here, we've got cedars along the main avenue, the same as we saw on King's Avenue leading up to Parliament House. So we've got cedars lining the whole boulevard on both of these triangles here. And so it just emphasises my point of how important these cedars are to the plan of Canberra, that they're just placing them everywhere. Okay, so now turned around, we can see the Hyatt Hotel, and if we look here, we can see a cypress tree, and over there, as part of the building, you can see the cypress, and we've got a cluster of cedar trees here with another cypress tree, and again, just showing that the repetition of the cedar tree or the cypress or the oak in the Canberra plan. Okay, we're standing here on City Hill, which is in the centre of Vernon Circle here, just near the city. We're in this kind of hexagon kind of arrangement in Griffin's plan. So City Hill's an interesting little hill here. There's no real easy pedestrian access to it, so it's a very empty park most of the time. And in 1921, as part of a Griffin plan, Charles Weston planted all these Roman cypresses, and you can see the cypress makes up the majority of the trees on this hill. There's also some Monterey pines. And the cypresses, you can see they're extremely old, so these are almost 100-year-old cypresses, and they're planted in clusters of 12 oval-shaped plantings all around here. They mark out the avenues that go off from here. So you've got Constitution Avenue, you've got Commonwealth Avenue, Northbourne Avenue, and also off there towards Black Mountain. The cypress, as we talked about, is a tree of the underworld, representing funeral and death. So I just found it interesting that they chose to plant this tree here in the center of what should be like the landmark of the city, that they're representing death. And as we know, we talked about as well, the cypress is used in magic ritual to summon gods of the underworld or entities of the underworld. And so obviously sitting here on top of this desolate hill would probably be a really good place to do one of those rituals that involve drawing in the entities that are attached to the cypress tree. But as we've shown all around the Canberra plan, this is just anchoring some more of that energy into the plan here. And as we can see, it funnels it down all these avenues, I guess amplifying maybe ley lines of energy perhaps in, and having that amplify up there towards Parliament House in Griffin's design. Okay, we're here at the National Arboretum and we're looking out towards Black Mountain. You can see the tower out there, and down the bottom is the oak plantation, which was part of Walter Burley Griffin's original design for Canberra. So that forest has been down there since the 1920s. To our right here is the Himalayan cedar forest that has been planted here. There used to be a Himalayan forest here on the site of the Arboretum that was destroyed in a 2003 bushfires, but since they've created the new Arboretum here in Canberra, we've got this new Himalayan cedar forest. Yeah, and I find it interesting that you've got big plantation of oaks and you've got a big plantation of cedars right here, and it's just again emphasizing how common these trees are in the Canberra plan. So we'll walk down in the forest and take a few shots. Find it interesting here that Frank Lloyd Wright is one of the architects that Griffin worked with. Yeah, I find it interesting here that Frank Lloyd Wright is one of the architects that was inspired Griffin. I think he even worked with Griffin for a while. One of the features of Walter Griffin's plan was he gave directions to make sure that Himalayan cedar and cork oak were planted in his proposed arboretum for the capital. Okay, we're here. This is a National Arboretum building, and we're looking out here. We can see Parliament House and Canberra there, and over here is the chapel here at National Arboretum. We're standing at the edge of the chapel here at the National Arboretum. We're looking out over Canberra. So if you look down there just in front of a lake, you can see
There's a really new cypress plantation that they've put there, so following along the theme we've been talking about today. And so if we look out to the left here, you can see there's the Himalayan cedar forest, and on the other side of that is where we've got the oak forest. So the, all three of those are prominently featured here at the National Arboretum. Okay, so we've seen today a lot of the aspect. We've looked at the granite rock and the limestone that forms a big aspect of the ritual centre of the Canberra space, with New Parliament House on top of the limestone plains of Canberra, and how that energy is directed into that black granite stone, which kind of acts as the magic pillar, with the potential of connecting to interdimensional worlds. And we've looked at the trees, how they're denoted around the major thoroughfares and ley lines of Canberra. We've discussed how these trees are have ancient links and also used in magic ritual for summoning spirits. And the other thing I wanted to touch on about the red cedar is the red cedar is actually not a cedar at all, it's actually a juniper. The juniper is also known as the eastern cedar. And the juniper in legend, particularly in like the Old Testament, a juniper with an angelic presence sheltered the prophet Elijah from Queen Jezebel's pursuit. In ancient Samaria and Babylonia, juniper was burned as a sacrifice to the gods. And the Native Americans noted juniper for its connection with spiritual entities. And the one thing I wanted to talk about in terms of the juniper is it's, so when the red cedar is was used in Solomon's Temple, it's used in New Parliament House for it because it's the most aromatic cedar, and the aromas are what is talked about in elemental magic ritual as being able to bring the spirits, draw the spirits into that ritual space, and give them some kind of elemental etheric substance for them to materialize and access our space here from their interdimensional place. So with the juniper, the actual Aboriginal word for juniper is Canberra, and we can see that that sounds very similar to the name of Canberra. There is some debate about where the name Canberra came from. Some people explain that it's the Aboriginal word for meeting place. It's inconclusive where that came from, and I find it interesting that everything we've talked about today with the trees, that Canberra is the Aboriginal word for the juniper, which is red cedar, or the eastern cedar is similar to a red cedar. So, and the other aspect of Canberra is the Ra part, and Ra was the sun god in ancient Egypt. In ancient Samaria, the god Marduk is sometimes linked with the Egyptian god Ra. It's interesting that Marduk is the god of the juniper, and he's also the sun god. And we see in the magic book, the Babylonian prayers to Marduk, it outlines how you use juniper incense to in front of a statue of Marduk to summon and invoke Marduk. And in the Necronomium spellbook, he's described as being connected with the planet Jupiter, which is very similar to the word juniper. When we talk about Griffin and his astrological links to Canberra, we haven't really had a chance to touch on that today, but there's a lot of symbolism and axiality in the design of Canberra that relates to Jupiter and also the sun. And so I talk in some of my research, I go into the fact that the sun that is worshipped as the sun in ancient Egypt is not our sun. It's actually a sun in the Taurus constellation called Aldebaran. You can see there's lots of symbolism to the bull and Taurus and Aldebaran in the Canberra plan. Marduk was also known as the bull calf in Sumerian lore. So there's all these links between what we talked about today and some of the astrological alignments in Canberra that kind of feed into all this premise that this ritual space is created to create a connection to these gods and to impact on the consciousness of man. And this is something that Griffin talked about when he was designing his space, ritual space here, where he talked about that it was using the landscape, so using these trees, using the granite, using the limestone to amplify the ritual space, to connect us to some higher form of spirituality. Where I go in my work is I talk about how this relates to individual identity and consciousness. So my belief and what I've really outline in my book is how these ritual spaces are actually designed to kind of corrupt our natural aspect of identity, and these energies that are created and stirred up, and what we try to, or what people try to channel in the magic ritual space, are designed to create changes in identity and this environmental stimuli where you've got entities coming into the space, were drawn in by these substances, can impact on the consciousness of man. And this is what Griffin talked about in his whole plan for Canberra, is that it was designed to imbue a new form of consciousness into mankind. Yeah, I see this whole plan of Canberra is designed as a giant ritual edifice. It's designed to change consciousness in mankind. So it's up for the viewer to decide for themselves whether this is a good or bad thing. I hope in time I get my book out so I can establish why I believe that it's not necessarily a good thing for us to be in these places that are really infused with these energies on a grand scale. All right, thank you.
And thank you, James. Great to have your perspective on Canberra.
Sometime after the video shoot in Canberra with James, he sent this audio summary, so I'll just add it on to the end of the video here.
So the main theme I want to address is the fact we see the cedar trees aligned along the avenues of the parliamentary triangle. One source on magic ritual states that the spirits of the cedar are said to be both powerful and persistent, and the aroma of cedar is said to induce psychic powers. In magic, the Triangle of Solomon is used in conjunction with the magic circle. The triangle is to sit outside the magic circle, just a few feet away. So we see that with the Parliament Triangle, and then the circle encompassing New Parliament House. The Triangle of Solomon is one of the most important tools in the conjuring of spirits in magic ritual. It is in this triangle that they appear. The incense used, the aromas of these elemental forces, are claimed in magical texts to provide the necessary physical substance for the being invoked to emerge in physical form. And these aromas also serve as an aid to alter the magician's consciousness to allow this transfer to occur. And the magic circle holds this atmosphere suitable for the magician, and the magical triangle contains the atmosphere relevant to the being evoked. And this is something Griffin highlighted about his design for Canberra, reaffirming there was this atmosphere created that could never hold form and substance. So I think what Griffin was really saying, if we read between the lines, is about this kind of astral atmosphere that's created. So I just want to conclude with something that was said by Czech magician and teacher of hermetics Franz Baden. The Baden Companion book, written by Ron Clark, cites, "Like the geometric form of a circle, the geometric form of a mundane triangle has no inherent power. But as before, the magical triangle does possess its own specific power. Through the law of analogy, the magical triangle represents a cohesive power of the manifestation or form. This does not just refer to forms composed of physical substance, but also to forms composed of mental and astral substance." So we see this theme in all magical texts about the circle and the triangle and the invocation of spirits and how they use elemental forces, specifically aromas and other elemental forces such as like the granite rock and everything, to allow this process to happen.